This place is heart-stopping in awesomeness. You see nature at its peak. I mean, it's beautiful. Whatever decisions I take in my life, I take with the principle that I'm going. Once I sit down and I have something in front of me that is an objective, there are very few things in the world that stop me, and they usually are things that I cannot control. In my mind, I think obstacles are put in our way to test our resolve. So if because obstacles come your way, you stop, it's a sign that your conviction was weak.
Just about a week before this ride, I had too many things going on and I needed a break and decided that, you know, okay, let's go. And Rohit actually was the one who pushed me to come on this ride, to just apply for leave and get rid of everything and then just go on the ride.
I think for me, riding is a way for me to get away from a lot of things and potentially get things off my mind, refresh myself, you know, forget about every other thing. The irony of it is my wife talked me into going on this ride.
I feel that the convictions with which you do everything, whether it's your leisure or something that you do on the side as a hobby, or it's your business, it's the same convictions. It's the same passion, it's the same principles. On Thursday, we had hired a vehicle. We had prepared to have that vehicle follow us for 3 weeks. We all got to the rendezvous point. We got there a few minutes before six, and 2 hours later, the vehicle has still not shown up. Eventually, we decided, okay, let's go home and take my truck. We got to the house, and something unusual also followed.
The bike was working fine. This bike has never given me any problems, ever. Surprisingly, as soon as we parked at Mr. T's place, when we were ready to take off, when all the stuff was packed in the car and we were ready to go, put on the switch on the key and there's no light, there's nothing coming on. Ferber helped me check. He did quite a bit of handwork. One of Mr. T's mechanics rushed and came to the place in under half an hour, I think, and sorted the problem out.
10:30, we were just about gathering ourselves to say, let us go. Four of us were on motorcycles that day, and two of us, myself and Ferber, had ridden over and over and over to several destinations and experienced all sorts of things and got to our destinations at very early hours of the morning. But we had two people that were riding with us that was their first time of going that far off, you know, and I was thinking of so many things.
What's different about this ride is the roads are crazy. But funny enough, man, I'm impressed. You know, there's so much resilience in us, and we don't know this till we actually test ourselves and push ourselves to the limit.
It was a long, beautiful ride for the first few hours, and this bike is a heavy, heavy, heavy machine. And handling this one on sand or on stone or on bad roads is a nightmare.
I was told we're going to get here by like 7 if we leave like 6, so 12, 13 hours of riding. I was like, what's the worst that can happen?
By our calculations, we're supposed to be hanging out, you know, right in front of the mountains and the beautiful sights in Ogudu.
We thought we'd be in Ogudu by now, but here we are still in Umuahia here.
We're at Ogudu Cattle Ranch now, and we got here around 2 a.m. this morning. We got separated with Niyi and the crew. They slept in Umuahia here, you know, because they veered off into Oweri, which is like going farther away from the resort, while we try to maintain a steady course.
Making plans to continue the journey this morning because of our rough experiences.
All our luggage in the truck. We're still wearing our riding outfit because there's nothing to wear. Frost is still wearing his, he slept maybe in his riding boots. The ride to Ubudu was one of the most challenging rides I've had in my entire life to date. The roads that lead to this place, the government or whoever built this place or manages this place needs to do something about that road.
Let me tell you why we were kind of like more on point. And that's what we should have communicated to you, which we failed to do, right? Everybody we spoke to, we told them we're going to Enugu.
Oh, okay.
So they'll say, go this way. When we got to Enugu, we said, we're going to Abakaliki. They'll say, go this way. When we got to Abakaliki, we said, we're going to Ogoja. They said, go this way. So we didn't just say we're going to Obudu.
What is the best way to get to Obudu from Lagos if you're riding?
There are quite a number of options, but if you're coming from Lagos, the most direct route to come is to come through Benin City. Hit Onitsha, then Enugu.
Oh, so that's what we should have done yesterday.
Yes, so you went right.
Yeah, yeah.
From Enugu to Abakaliki, Lagos.
You get to Ogoja, and then yeah, it's a right turn.
It's a right turn.
To some junction.
From that right turn to the Obudu
so town,
to the mountain resort, is
64 kilometers.
Then 11 kilometers up the mountain. Yes.
Welcome the Eagle Motorcycle Club to Obudu Cattle Ranch. First of all, I would like to give you a little bit of a history on how the Obudu Cattle Ranch started. At the beginning, it started in 1949. And the first stranger that was on the mountain was a white man, though the villagers were already living. So the name of the first stranger was Mr. McCauley, who was a ranger. So when he saw this area, he now saw that the place was good for ranch business. He now went back to Scotland and England to invite one Mr. Jones and Major Cranfield, who were proper ranchers, to come and establish a ranch. So that is how it started. And at about 1960, when they saw that the area is good for hotel and tourism, when the ENDC we on board, they decided to start the first hotel and tourism on the mountain. So this is when it started. Today, I'll be taking you to the intersection of the road viewpoint so that you can see the wonderful mountain road you took your bike from the bottom to the top. I'm also going to take you to Bechebe Nature Reserve, where we have the canopy walkway, the grotto, Holy Mountain, Cameron border view, and the view of the falling water from the mountain. Right now, we are beginning the tour from here. At this point is the car park, and we're about 1,600 meters above sea level. We are now standing on top of the intersection of the road viewpoint. So at this point now, it's one of the best views that if you are standing on top, you can get views of different sites on the mountain. Also, accommodations that we are selling in our resort. So if you throw your eyes by the other side across, see those cabins you are seeing? Those are the mountain villas. Wow. Mountain villas is another grade of accommodation we sell in our hotel. Though they are wooden chalet. All the materials for the construction of those cabins were imported from Finland. Then on the other side is the presidential villa.
That's the one on top there.
On top, yeah.
Yeah, that's what you
that's the presidential
at.
Villa, yeah. And then the other corner there is a proposed education center.
Wow.
And right inside the middle of the forest where you can see something like an umbrella. That is the canopy walkway. At that point is the viewing tower of the canopy walkway. And the other side there is the lower ranch, the lower part of the resort, where we also have a lower grade of accommodation. At that point, we have accommodation like the standard double chalet, superior double, executive suite, governor's lodge, presidential suite, and the royal suite. The other section you're seeing by the left side, that one is a village. That village, we call it Kigold Village.
Kigold Village.
Kigold Village. That is a village in which our royal chief is staying. The last mountain at the other side,
yes.
That part is in Cameroon.
Wow.
Yes. Yeah. That is the beginning of the Takamanda National Park.
I'm 47 years old now. I've traveled a lot of places in the world. I did not know in my wildest imagination anything like this existed in my home country, in Nigeria. I never knew it. From the bottom to the resort itself is 11 kilometers of windy, snaky roads that had about 34 turns, very sharp ones. So, but we really didn't see what was really going on until we got here and we woke up in the morning and we were like,
One of the beauty of this kind of work is when every angle you turn is a photographic delight.
So this way now, we are heading to the Holy Mountain, Cataract View, and Cameroon Border View. If you turn your eyes by the left, you start to enjoy the view of the waterfall across. We are now on top of the Cameroon Border View.
This place is heart-stopping in awesomeness. You know, the mountain ranges, the mountains, as you see the clouds, you see nature at its peak. I mean, it's beautiful.
The other side now, we are looking at a waterfall. The cataract is about 100 meters high from the dropping point to the top. The name of the water is called River Avase. That flows down to River Cross. That's the headwater for River Cross. When you're coming from Calabar, that bridge you cross at Ekom, this is the headwater. Yeah.
The place is really beautiful. This place is underutilized, honestly, because the place is stunning. It's mind-boggling. You have such amazing mountains, such beautiful scenery. You have so much of untouched landscape here that they could do so much with this place.
I know that if the Asians or the Europeans or the Americans had what this place have right now, the amount of money this place would be generating right now in foreign currency would be ridiculous. This place is just like somebody sitting on a gold mine and then waking up every morning, brushing his teeth and then staring at the sky. And nothing is happening with the gold. It's exactly what this place is.
We're approaching another waterfall. This is after walking almost 5 minutes down here. And I'm very sure all the guys are getting ready to jump in.
Today we went to a little pond, a small waterfall, freezing cold water, which I loved. That probably healed all the pains in my body. But
I think Ubudu is bliss. Ubudu is awesome. Extremely, it's fantastic. I swear in my life I've never ever seen anywhere like this. It's beautiful, man. It's nature at its peak. You don't want to imagine. It's unimaginable. I never saw this coming, I swear though. So much to do. I swear, it's a place you'll probably spend a week, 2 weeks, and do something different every day if you take your time, you know.
All right, people, we're in the cable car, Ubudu Kato Ranch.
Wow! Can you see all that?
It's a water park or something.
It's amazing.
Yesterday we did the cable car, which was again really beautiful. Mr. T almost freaked out and threw up, but he survived. Yeah. He survived.
It's
what?
It's a nature reserve.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I don't know the gorillas.
I don't care about heights. That's good as right. Statue doesn't like heights. I don't care.
We got into the cable car, That ride changed my life. I won't lie to you. Because the view is heart-stopping. You know, and it made me feel bad. A little bit that my country has this much potential. And it's just here. I mean, you can see that there's not much traffic. You can see that there's not much going on.
It's government-owned, sadly, unfortunately. Something has to change, because this is just a waste. It's a
very stunning beautiful experience.
This country has so much potential. If we will just understand what we have and actually make the sacrifice to make it what it should be.
I mean, even if people had described this experience for me, it wouldn't have matched, you know, anywhere close to what I have experienced myself. This is the Ogbudu you have never seen. That's the tagline.
Because I'm not going that high, man. You guys are on your own.
Okay.
Your plastic ball has taken over.
Give me 5 for that one.
Yeah, a story here, like the ranch, the mountain, at the beginning of it, the villagers, the community was already living on the mountain. And if you see, we have 6 villages on the mountain. Those 6 villages represent the first 6 hunting sheds on the mountain. Because on the mountain, what people do is they were hunters. So when they saw that the area was good enough that they can plant their banana, cocoyam, and also kill the bush animal that could feed their families, they now decided to go back and pack their families to come and stay on the first 6 villages that we have on the mountain.
What's the name of your village? Kigo.
Okay.
See my friends up there, they're coming down now. I didn't go because I'm afraid of the hill. Many people used to be afraid, so they don't go up. So I'm not the only one. I don't like it, it's too high. But you go there, you go to that hill, where that car is, and you're not afraid.
I'm going to give you small money because you're a good boy. Take.
Welcome. What will you do with it? You have not paid your school fees. You have not paid your school fees. Why? Wow, your daddy hasn't paid. How much is the school fees? 400 naira. 400 naira for one term. Wow. So you go and pay it from that money. Very nice, very nice. I'm happy that you can pay your school fees. Shake my hand. All right. Greet your people for me, your parents. Say hello to them, okay?
How I survived through the mountain, I have my elder sister that was about 15 years of age that was taking care of me. So after that, I have to become a tour guide at the age of 11 years, self-employed, before coming to work with the resort now for 5 years. So I've been like a tour guide for more than 26 years today on the mountain. My father was the first steward for the first man that came on the mountain, that is Mr. Sunday Amele. He was the steward for the first white people that were on the mountain. And then I become as a tour guide, I was first a hunter. So I hunt all the trails and all the mountains on the ranch. So I now saw most of the attractive areas and I knew that they were very nice. So when tourists were not coming, when they mentioned I want to see waterfall, I would know where to take them to waterfall. When they say I want to see the forest, I know where to take them to forest. When they need jungle views, I take them to jungle views.
We're filming this with one of the best film crews I know. I mean, and with the best photographers that I know, so that we can share this experience with our families, with our friends, with the world.
basically, it's just about spending time with the guys, quality time. You know, they're more like family than friends. We get to choose our friends, but you know, we don't really get to choose our family. And I think friends are more important.
Kind of experiences you get on a ride like this, you can't buy it. You can only attempt it. You cannot buy it.
Emotionally, mentally, physically, we share a lot on these rides, and I think every ride we do get us closer to each other. So.
Backed up. We're loading it and taking it to Lagos.
Have to appreciate the Eagle Back riders for taking the pains of riding the rough road from right on Bok Junction to this area. So the experience with them is I really like them because they have love with nature.
Our objective is to inspire and to educate. We want to show people what our country has. We want to show people that being a biker is not necessarily being an irresponsible person who just wants to make noise. We want to use this hobby that we have to capture what the benefits and the positives of our country and show the world that life can be exciting, life can be interesting, and at the same time that we have so much here if we will only believe in ourselves.
You.